Asmara, the capital of modern-day Eritrea. Asmara is an astonishing place. Its architecture doesn't resemble that of Ethiopia, from which the country gained independence in 1993. But Italy, the country which colonized this part of Africa from the end of the 19th century until the Second World War. In the early years of their rule, the Italians introduced a bewildering range of architectural styles to Asmara. The city's old town square offers the perfect example.
Behind me, a typical neoclassical building, quite vernacular, expressing the roofs. You have, dominating the square, the post office building with its strict, sort of austere classicism, beautiful colors. But then look at this creature over here, a Baroque building with the swooping stairs and the strange cupola. A 50s building with strong lines and punched out windows. And then the surprise, look at this, a neoclassical building which acknowledges a kind of arabesque sort of arcade, and another symmetrical palace building which then completes the ensemble. Now, as an architect, I'm completely confused. I mean, it's very beautiful, but it's really a mishmash. But, you know, to the ordinary eye, this works very, very well.
Asmara's mix of building styles defined the city's architecture in the early 20th century. But the Italian taste for the eclectic didn't last. By the 1930s, Italy's fascist dictator, Benito Mussolini, decided to impose a rigid fascist aesthetic on this corner of his new Roman Empire. Like Hitler, Mussolini wanted to express his power through architecture, so he decreed that the new Asmara would be built according to his preferred architectural style, namely modernism. This must be one of Africa's most remarkable buildings. A petrol station constructed in the shape of a giant aeroplane. Designed by one of Mussolini's favorite architects, Giuseppe Petazzi, the 1938 Fiat gas station is a splendid example of a branch of modernist architecture known as Futurism. It used to be said of this beautiful, fossilized pterodactyl of a building that its design reflected the longing of homesick colonials to return to Europe.
There's a great story about this building. Petazzi, when he had to submit these plans to the local authority, faced a huge problem. They just didn't believe that a concrete structure with a 16-meter cantilever looking like this could stand up. So they forced him to put lots of little columns underneath in order for them to approve it. Anyway, when the structure was built, he was reported to have held a gun to the builder's head and ordered him to take away all the columns. And lo and behold, it's standing up.
At the height of the occupation, 70,000 Italian civilians were drafted into Asmara to build Mussolini's model city. To keep them entertained, in 1937, Mussolini's authorities built this, the Odeon Cinema, one of five picture palaces in Asmara. The elegant foyer looks like it was ripped out of a set from a classic movie, with its subtle backlighting and sumptuous fittings. Upstairs, Mussolini's architects gave the Odeon's function room a racy and willfully eccentric sloping ceiling. It's easy to fall for a place like Asmara, which is what happened to Eritrean architect Nagzi Gebremedin. I met him in front of one of his favorite buildings, the 1937 Selam Hotel. Its style is rationalist, a branch of modernism that favors the simple, the brutal, and the ruthlessly functional.
Fashion sort of adopted this rationalist style and made it one of its own. Yes. Many of the Italian rationalist architects then began to both adopt the orthodox fascist political stance, and they kept on practicing architecture of this absolutely remarkable but very simple and excellent building forms.
Yes, it's interesting. It's that moment when architecture and politics sort of suddenly become bedfellows because of opportunity, really.
Exactly.
here now?
Yes, we're coming to the Casa dell'Italiani now, but originally it was the Casa del Balilla, which is the fascist youth club.
Uh-huh.
And you could see that on each side of the entrance we have the fascia, which is the traditional sign.
Uh-huh.
It's a bunch of reeds tied together, and it's the fascist sign, the fascist uh-huh. symbol.
Right.
And the head of it, there used to be a little axe. I think that has been removed.
So it's a fascist club for boys?
Used to be, but uh-huh. now it is a club for the Italian community and Italian-speaking Eritreans.
Of course, most of Mussolini's architecture wasn't designed for the natives. The Italians imposed strict social segregation, leaving most Eritreans sidelined and marginalized. Nevertheless, many Asmarinos, as they're called, retain a certain affection for Mussolini's cultural legacy.
I would say that there is, in Eritrean minds, there is two separate issues here. One is the physical infrastructure, and no one quarrels with that. It's of very good quality. The Italians spent absolutely no effort at all in creating the best, but I don't know of any Eritrean who would excuse or in any way accept any kind of the terrible colonial system that was operating here. So it must be clear to separate these two.
Despite these physical reminders of their colonial subjugation, you can see why so many Asmarinos love their city. Even an outwardly unprepossessing apartment block can hide a beautiful architectural surprise.
There you are.
Fantastic.
Look at that.
Wow. It's completely amazing. A ribbon stand. It's absolutely beautiful. So 6 or 7 flats serving off this coil. Wow.
That's right. Yes.
It's beautiful. It's really seamless and so simple.
Yes.
Hidden gems like this are all over Asmara. The city, which is now a World Heritage Site, has a unique charm. Undoubtedly, Asmara is an exceptional city, but Africa has a habit of surprising the untutored eye.